working?
Yeah.
Oh. Gotta get to work here then. Live from the International Film Studios, the McNeil International Film Studios, we have our discussion today about externalities. Externalities, the definition is, they are costs or benefits of production or consumption that affect third parties who don't want to be affected, who are not part of the deal. Examples. Examples of external costs are pollution. If I own a factory and I get to blow smoke on my neighbors and or dump wastewater into the local river, I get to dump some of the costs of my production onto third parties who have nothing to do with my production. Smoking, noisy neighbors, rotten noisy neighbors, the ones nearby actually. External benefits, an example, flu shots, inventions, bees. If I have a hive of bees, then they'll benefit the neighboring farms and so forth. Now, when it comes to external costs and benefits, there are allocation problems. That means that the society will not be allocating its resources correctly. There will either be an over-allocation problem, as is the case with external costs, or an under-allocation problem if there are external benefits associated with the production or consumption of some good. So, let's get to it a little bit and explain why. First, let's start with external benefits. With external benefits, there's an under-allocation. There will be too few resources sent to this area of production and too many to some other area of production. That is, too few for the well-being of the society. External benefits are also known as positive externalities. I'll give you an example of why there's an under-allocation problem when external benefits exist. Here's why. We make decisions based on our personal costs and benefits, and marginal costs and benefits. And if the marginal benefits of an action exceed the marginal costs, then we do it. But if the marginal costs exceed the marginal benefits, we don't. But sometimes, when there are external costs and benefits, there's a difference between the costs or benefits that I experience and those that fall on the society as a whole. For instance, I used to live in a rotten house. The plaster was falling off the outside. The shingles were falling off the roof. The bushes were a mess. The grass was a mess, and my neighbors hated me. And I refused to clean it up because I'm a trained economist and I did the calculations. Here were the calculations. To fix up my house was going to cost me $25,000. That was my cost and I was going to pay it off. All. It was a private cost to me. But if we look at the benefits, my benefit from fixing up my house was $19,000. My house value would increase $19,000. So I didn't do it, and I wouldn't do it, because my marginal cost was $25,000, and my marginal benefit was $19,000. But from the social point of view, there were external benefits to my fixing up my house. My neighbors would live better. Their houses would be worth more. It would be easier to sell their house because they weren't living in a neighborhood that had such a rundown house. And so the benefits to all of my neighbors, the external benefits, the ones that don't apply to me at all, are $9,000. So if we look at the social benefits, are $19,000 private and $9,000 external, which means the total social benefit is $28,000 and the social cost is only $25,000. From society's point of view, it should be done. The resources should be allocated to fixing up my house, and if it were to happen, the world would be a better place. But would I do it? I would not. Why not? Well, I cooked up a plan. I think that anybody who benefits should pay. So, I was thinking about going door to door down my block and telling people, I'm thinking of fixing up my house, and if I do that, you're going to benefit. The people nearest me will benefit like $1,000 worth. So they can pay $1,000, and then down the block, $500, $300, at the very ends, maybe just a couple of hundred. And that would collect the $9,000, maybe $10,000 that would get me to go ahead and do this, if I could collect it, you see? So it would reduce my costs enough that I would fix the under allocation problem associated with this external benefits. But would my neighbors go for it? They would not. And did I do it? I did not, because I made my decisions based on my private costs and benefits. So, will I do it? No! Should I do it? Should it be done from society's point of view? Yes! Are there any remedies to fix this problem? Well, the normal remedy is to subsidize. Fullerton used to have a fix-up Fullerton program, and anybody like me that had a rundown house, somebody would come and knock on my door and say, hello, I'm from the city of Fullerton, and you know, we have a fix-up Fullerton program. We will subsidize you. We will help you with this and that. We will give you low-interest loans. And if it's $9,000 worth, or what do I need? I only need $6,000 worth. If it's $6,000 worth of benefits, would I do it then? And the answer is yes, I would. So that's one remedy. Another example of external benefits is me getting a flu shot. I don't like to get flu shots. They cost me $25 and I hate needles. Now when I get a flu shot, I'm better off. But is everybody else better off as well? Are there external benefits? Yes. Do I consider others' benefit when I decide to go under the needle? And the answer is, I don't. Is that, will there be too few flu shots with this arrangement? And the answer is yes. So what is the remedy? The remedy is that the government says,
buy a smaller needle.
Come and get a flu shot. We'll only charge you $10. They subsidize it $15. And does that make my personal costs and benefits such that I will go get a flu shot and make everybody better off in the process? And the answer is yes. All right, what about external costs? Well, these are called negative externalities, and there will be an overallocation problem. That is, there will be too much of it done for the well-being of the society when external costs exist in the production or consumption of a good. And I've given the example of pollution. Let's say I'm a manufacturer. I have private costs of producing this thing, whatever it is, $400. But in the process, I pollute my neighborhoods. I dump stuff into rivers that kills the fish, and all the people around suffer, either because they can't use the river or because their kids get asthma and their tires rot and the paint on their cars chip and the kids can't play when I'm blowing smoke on and so forth. So they eat $100 worth of the cost. So the social cost, that is the private plus the external, the total social cost is $500. What cost do I consider? These, the $400, the private costs. Now somebody is willing to pay me $410 for this. That's the private benefit. Will the thing be produced? Yes. Will it be purchased? Yes. Will there be $100 worth of pollution? Yes, if I don't have to consider other people's costs? Yes. And will there be too much of it done for the well-being of the society? Same questions. Will this item be produced? Yes, because the private costs are $400 and the private benefits, that is whoever's going to buy it from me, is willing to pay me $410. That's what I will get for it. So I will produce it. But should it be produced? Not from the society's point of view, because the social costs are $500, but the benefits to someone are only $410. So it shouldn't be. I know, it's a terrible problem. So are there remedies? And the answer is yes, there are. The remedies can be found in one of the later chapters in any econ textbook. It has to do with the environment or the economics of the environment or pollution or whatever. And there's a full chapter on economists' contribution to this issue. Another example of this is smoking. If I want to smoke indoors and there are other people around, will there be external costs? Yes. And if I don't have to concern myself with the external costs, will I smoke too much for the well-being of the group? And the answer is yes. So, that's it. External costs and benefits.
You nicotine addict.